All right, can I bore you with one more satsang? Why not, right? Because turmoil is coming. We can see that things are not getting better. The crisis in Europe is not getting better. It's getting worse, a lot worse. And therefore, in Europe, there's a great rush to find a safe haven for money, meaning stability. How can we be stable in the future? What's the best way to go? In the world, there should be a great rush for stability, spiritual stability, which is the ultimate stability. It's the true stability. The ultimate stability is to remember what we are. Existence is literally a deep forgetfulness of what we are. And existence is totally unstable. Why? Because that enables us to forget what we are. Instability enables us to forget what we are, because what we are is perfectly stable. So we are continuing on in existence with this instability. And it's getting very intense, and will get more intense. The next 5 months should be extremely intense time. So therefore, we have another boring satsang here going over the basics. And yet it's a good way to spend time. It's not good to wait until it's too late, because then the tools, one will not have the tools, one will not know how to use the tools. It's necessary to become proficient ahead of time. And I know people say, oh, you know, you're fear-mongering, you know. Well, it's necessary to wake people up and say, get to work right now before it's too late, to develop, get the tools, get used to using the tools, become proficient, and make real headway towards peace of mind. It's necessary to do that prior to the troubles really getting very intense. So any warning has to be an advanced warning. Otherwise, there's no warning at all, right? I remember the warnings about Katrina, Hurricane Katrina. And it started out by saying, this is a dangerous hurricane. And then some started talking about this could really cause trouble. And then it multiplied to, you know, you really need to get out of town. And eventually the order was, everybody has to leave. But there were a lot of people there who ignored all the warnings and stayed. They said, there's no way that this could be a perfect storm and breach the levees. We've heard all the warnings before, and they were always wrong. Well, guess what? This time they were right. So the defense that all warnings about the future, they've been wrong in the past, therefore they're certain to be wrong in the future, as we've just seen firsthand, is not true. The warnings about Katrina were accurate this time. And the people should have evacuated. They did not, for various reasons. And people said, well, they've heard warnings about instability coming in the world with the financial structure and the world, various countries and tensions, etc. But they say, well, that there's always been those troubles, that everything should be fine. There's always that superstorm, isn't there? There's always that perfect storm. And it seems like in this world we have been experiencing perfect storm scenarios recently. The Japanese tsunami was really like a perfect storm scenario. Indonesian tsunami was very bad. And Katrina. So, and then the Gulf of Mexico oil spill also was like a perfect storm scenario. Just so many things, unexpected things happened. There's a book called The Black Swan, which just points out this basic thing, that something unexpected can happen that we don't think it ever possibly could happen, and therefore we don't prepare for it. And when it does happen, it has unintended consequences. And the world now is so fragile and interdependent, and there's so much rotten foundation to the whole financial structure of the planet, that an unexpected incident, I call it a precipitating event, could easily tilt things into unexpected channels. And those of us who have seen this ahead of time and have prepared for it through satsang, through listening to clarifications about truth and about what our options are, we're ahead of the game, way ahead of the game. And I've always advised that the best preparation is spiritual preparation, attending satsang, listening to truth. Very, very best, and that's what I've always advocated, because peace of mind will be the most important tool that anyone has going forward. And what we're aiming for is to abide in peacefulness, in perfect peace, to continuously experience perfect peace, which it will be untouched by anything that happens in existence. And in all my videos here, it's been explained, where does that perfect peace come from? It comes from choosing a new idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator gives rise to one effect, and that one effect is not being modified. It's totally stable. So when one chooses a new idea, not trying to be prime creator, gives up the attempt to be prime creator, one experiences stability, perfect stability. It's called perfect peace, peace beyond understanding. Because there's nothing changing, nothing being modified with this effect. It's completely steady. It never gets more, never gets less. So that's the great pearl of great price. That's the ultimate goal. That's the goal we can reach. The only reason why we don't reach it is because the ego is so clever at postponing the inevitable, postponing us from choosing this perfect peace. And we've worked through that in other videos to some extent, for sure. It's very valuable to bring to light the tactics that the ego uses to postpone it for us, because the only thing we're suffering from is delay. Truly, if you melt it down, boil it down, delay is the only issue we have. And therefore, any effective satsang needs to at least address this issue of delay. Why are we delaying? What do we fear? What do we think we'll get out of delay? And what we're doing here is trying to elevate this satsang into a very high satsang, because the times that are coming are very intense changes, modifications, turmoil. So we need to have the tools to be able to turn away from that and maintain our focus and hopefully choose a new idea and experience that stability, perfect stability. Those who experience this perfect stability, who have made this choice to repent, to let go of the attempt to be prime creator, it's called letting go of that, it's called repentance, surrender, letting go, exchanging belief systems, there are various terms for it. Those who have actually done that abide in this perfect peace. And those are called touchstones. I call those touchstones. Meaning they set an example for everyone else. Anyone can go and see this example and say, aha, it's possible. I see it for myself. I'm experiencing it for myself. I know it's possible. Now, there have been touchstones in history that have come onto this planet for us, to help us out. And the people of that time would go and see them, and they would come away, you know, with this deep conviction that it is possible. There is this peace beyond understanding. There's this perfectly stable experience, and we have access to it. And then they would become very motivated to get to that. So that has happened. It's happened over and over and over again on this planet. But what we need to focus on right now is the fact that situations on this planet have amplified. We now have 7 billion people on the planet. And many of them are very, very active at the personality level. And witnessing for delay. We have just an absolute cornucopia, an outpouring of media and music and movies and videos and apps and everything else just like mushrooming so fast around the planet. All of this is simply witnessing for delay, for distraction. None of it is focused on satsang, what we're focused on right here. So the distraction at this time is almost incalculably greater than it has been in the past. So it's actually much, much more difficult in this day and age to repent and choose a new idea, because we are surrounded by a vast ocean of those advocating delay. It's not just a small village and a few people in the village advocating it. It's not our aunts and uncles and etc. advocating delay. It is the global community that is advocating delay. It's a global community that is amplifying the egoic agenda. Global community of 7 billion people are advocating that. So we feel it translates into reluctance. Even though we can be very clear, there's still this reluctance in this day and age. And so, as we look for modern day touchstones, I would say it's absolutely imperative that there be some touchstones in this day and age, because it's different now. Touchstone in last century, 19th century, 20th century, they faced a less intense delay. A situation of much less intensity as far as delays goes. Sure, there was severe delay, always is in existence, but right now we have severe delay on steroids, really. So it would be extremely helpful if there were some touchstones in this day and age. I've searched for them, saying there must be something very profound to help us out. It certainly would be helpful to have for a touchstone to be here, and we could say, aha, you see, right now, right here, right now, even in this information age, this global village where we're being pummeled from all directions and pushed and attracted and given all sorts of demands and pressured into accepting the ego's agenda, continuing to go along with that, that even in the midst of that, there is someone, a perfect example of choosing a new idea and abiding in the perfect peace beyond understanding, the seamless vision of oneness. Here is the perfect example. That would be tremendous help for us. As of yet, I have not found an example. Not enough to really seemingly offset the times that we live in. But it would seem right now that it would be the ideal time for us to discover a perfect touchstone, one that simply abides in this peace beyond understanding at all moments, all times, and is able to impart that to us with great conviction and certainty. That would be immensely helpful for us, because we can talk all day and we can get clarify all day. But in the back of our mind, we're thinking, how can 7 billion people be wrong and I'm right? You know, that creeps into it. It always has. You can be entirely clear. You can see it crystal clear that delay is a lie, is based on a lie. All the tricks of the ego are lies. You can see that clearly. But still, the factor in the back of the mind, there's this feeling, you know, how can I possibly assert that I'm right and that 7 billion people are wrong? It's a barrier, isn't it? It's really just and it's hard to combat this barrier, because it's not based on anything other than just sheer bulk, you know, sheer numbers. That's what I've found, that no matter how clear I get, I still think, well, yeah, I can choose peace, but I'll be just one doing that, and 7 billion others will say, no, you're completely wrong, you're completely crazy, this is not the way to go. And how can one stand up against 7 billion? See, it's very different than one standing up against, 1 billion are 500 million, or as lesser populations in different cultures where there are many touchstones, it was not nearly so difficult because one didn't feel like one was standing up against the combined might of the world. You see, in this day and age, of sharing everything, there's just become a global community, like a groupthink sort of dynamic in the world, where everybody is locked into this groupthink. And the groupthink says, we've got 7 billion people all on the same page, and we're aware of it now. Or in the past, we live in a little village, we're not even aware of the world at all. And we'd sit in meditation there, and we'd become clear, and we'd choose peace beyond understanding. And the few villagers would say, huh, you're kind of weird, you know what that's about. And then you'd maybe wander off from the village and go to some other place and begin teaching, and the world was none the wiser. But today, everything is magnified. So anybody who has this, chose this peace beyond understanding, this perfectly stable experience. Everybody's got a smartphone, everybody's posting everything, goes viral all around the world. Everybody can tap into that, and they can then express their disapproval and saying, this doesn't fit with what we are, what we see as the right thing to do. The right thing to do, but the ego says a sacrifice is the right thing to do. And we've gone over that in other videos. But the fact is, just the sheer number and the activism of the world, the sheer activism of the times, very aggressive. I'm telling you, it's so different in the past. Today, if people disagree with you, they become very aggressive. They feel empowered to be extremely aggressive and try to intimidate. Whereas in the past, it's very, very civil, very polite, very kind, and it was very different. So you have 7 billion people, 7 billion activists, all screaming that you're wrong, and to drop this, peace, this experience of peace beyond understanding, this experience of total stability. It just seems like something significant, even though it may not be. It's tough for us. So we are in difficult times, and for the life of me, I cannot understand why we do not have access to more touchstones and the highest quality possible. I really feel that this time calls for the highest possible quality of touchstone, a perfect touchstone. It really does. If we don't get it, I feel it's going to be very difficult for us. Not impossible, but quite difficult. It's one thing for someone to go across go against the current of a little stream, like that. I relate this like to the past. The past might have been a little stream, and then more recently it goes against the current of a river. But these days it feels like we're going against the current of the ocean, of a tsunami. There's a tsunami of egoic intention in this world towards delay. And it seems to just be sweeping everything in its path. And here we are, one lone being, or several, just standing there saying, no, we're going to stand in the path of this tsunami. It can't touch us. It's doable, but very few are doing it. And a touchstone is one who stands there and effortlessly rejects the egoic agenda. Doesn't even make any effort to reject it. Simply abides in this perfect peace, this perfectly stable effect. Experiences that continuously without any effort. And then we see that and we say, aha, wow, that stability really enables one to do that. And it produces a chain reaction, chain cascading effect. It's kind of like a heartening thing. In ancient times, like in battles, they'd have like the great general, the great leader, when the tide was going against them. But what would happen was they'd have this great leader on a magnificent horse go out into the very center of the battle, lead the troops out in front. And somehow no arrows hit them, nothing happened to them, and everyone would see that and they'd say, "Oh my gosh, look, we're invincible." And the tide would turn. Many battles turned, the tide was turned by some leader going to the front lines and showing everyone else that they cannot be harmed, they cannot be touched, that it's destined, you know, victory is destined. And then suddenly the group would have a completely different outlook and the tide would be turned just like that. It's a group dynamic sort of thing. One invincible focus can change the whole perspective of many and turn the tide. Right now the world is very much intimidating us, trying to intimidate us. And although it may not succeed entirely, it succeeds enough to keep us from actually finishing the job and choosing a new idea and abiding in the peace beyond understanding, the seamless vision of oneness, the overlay. Just enough. It's just enough intimidation to prevent that, which is no good. So we need a finisher. We need something that helps us finish. That would be ideal. And you would think that during these times, that is what is called for. And yet, so far, we're out of luck. So far, we're out of luck. There are a few who are helpful in this around the world. There are a few. But certainly, we could benefit from a really perfect, immaculate example of that. It's very difficult to take a stand in today's world. It's becoming almost prohibitively difficult. It's amazing the polarization in people's minds. I'll tell you the way that the ego thinks. The ego pre-selects an outcome that it wants, and then it backfills with plausibility. It tries to build a sketchy rationale for it, as if it reached the outcome through employing this consideration and rationale, etc. But actually, the ego pre-selects an outcome and then just tries to throw whatever can stick, you know, whatever sticks, throws a whole bunch of stuff against a wall and hopefully some of it sticks, and then says, "Well, that's why I arrived at this conclusion." No, the ego pre-selects conclusions based on what it sees is most helpful for its agenda, and then tries to backfill it. That's literally how the ego works. Ego does not base its decisions on reason, on clarity at all, simply on expediency. And so the world now, I've noticed, is tremendously trained in this, especially the various, you know, political factions. You can see it in the message boards of comments, of political stories, just any news story, any comments on the internet. It's ubiquitous around the world that people have already, what they do is they are told, from guided by the ego, to accept a conclusion, that this is the conclusion you need to reach. And so just accept that as fact, and then simply try and provide a plausible backfill for it. And that's what's happening. So people are just arguing past each other. There's no real open ears going on. And it's amazing on the internet. I'm telling you, it's like night and day. Things did not used to be this bad at all. People would actually listen to each other with open ears, open heart, and respect for one another. And you could actually talk and consider what's being said, and then you also share some information, and you kind of say, "Well, thank you for, you know, the time of trying to clarify this," and then we would all then go on towards trying to clarify some more. There was not the hostility. There's not the personal attacks. At all. Wasn't like this at all. I'm guarantee you, this whole what the internet has exposed is this modern era, the era we're in right now, is an era of fanaticism. And that people simply talk right past each other because they're only looking to bolster up the conclusions that they have pre-selected. I'm this. This is what I want. Or I'm that. This is what I want. And however I reached it, I don't know, but it doesn't really matter. So we're just, there's no real listening with open ears at all. It's amazing. An era of fanaticism. And in such a situation, it's the ego is living large and in very much in control of this planet when that happens. It's a time of darkness when that happens. Even if the so-called goal seems to be a positive one, if there is no love and respect for others and no listening to what they're saying and no prejudging and all, if that's not there, then it's an era of darkness. Because ultimately, the voice of reason is what leads to the right conclusion, which leads to choosing a new idea. And if we don't have respect for one another, we'll never get there because it requires letting go of all these predetermined conclusions that the ego has given us. The ego gives us predetermined conclusions, and we accept the authority of the ego as if the ego were God. If we're an atheist, we don't call it God, but we're still accepting the conclusions of the ego. We just say, well, we're rational. We've come up with this rational conclusion. It's not. Voice of reason always leads to choosing a new idea, to experience, to abiding, to experiencing the effect of that idea, which is the effect of perfect stability. Always, the voice of reason, that is its direction, that is its purpose. So if one is not led in that direction, they're not listening to the voice of reason, listening to the voice of plausibility, listening to the ego. Whatever they call the ego, if they don't call it anything at all, they call it God, call it inner guidance, whatever. So, when listening to the voice of reason, it helps to be, one has to be very open-minded, open ears, not dumb, but respectful, civil, kind, loving, and compassionate. And feel that there's an atmosphere that enables one to reconsider all the conclusions that the ego feeds us and look at them and say, you know, that may not be right. Let's look at that a little more closely. It's like that. It's like, let's take a little closer look here. It's a whole attitude that you find in satsang that's different, right, than on the internet message boards. And I'm sure you can feel that here. It's not that we need to just can make that an end in itself. No, it's a means to an end. But there has to be an attitude of kindness present. It cannot be mean-spirited. But I find that the world has become very, very mean-spirited, very, very intolerant, very, very polarized, very, very activist, and very, very aggressive. And everyone's simply talking past each other in the middle ground. You know, the ground has evaporated, where you're immediately pegged as one thing or the other. But the fact is that those who are listening to the voice of reason and going towards choosing a new idea, they're not in any of those categories that the ego puts everyone into. The ego doesn't even recognize this category. It doesn't exist. So I find it impossible to have a conversation at all with anyone out in the social world, because what I'm talking about is something the ego has never mentioned as an option. So to them, they just say, I don't understand. But where's this person coming from? They're not this, or they're not that. So I just don't think they're anything. I cannot even relate to them. I can't speak to them at all. Whereas I'm able to speak with people from all different perspectives, whatever their egoic conclusions have been, I'm able to relate to that, whatever it is. and say, okay, I hear, you know, what you're saying, but now let's listen to the voice of reason and see what the voice of reason says. You know, we hear it from one side, let's hear it from the other now. Whereas the opposite is not true. The ego will not listen to the voice of reason. It rejects it. It says there is no such thing. That the ego says, well, you're just crazy. You know, basically what it says is, or just ignore it. Just ignore that person. Just ignore them. Pay no attention to them, like they're invisible. That's what happens. That's what's happened in this world. It's amazing. If you post something reasonable on the internet, you'll be ignored, largely ignored, because people cannot see what your position is. The ego, you know, they say, well, you're either on the left or on the right, and which is it? And if they can't tell which it is, they just say, forget it. You know, this is not, there's nothing here, nothing there. Move on. That's what happens. Amazing times we live in. Very dark times. Incredible darkness now, and I know some are saying that we're going into a time of incredible light. But I would say we'd have to make massive changes in order to even talk about something like that. And the trend is in the opposite direction. The momentum is in the opposite direction. You cannot ignore momentum. Okay. That's like someone living in a little village in the Alps, Swiss Alps, and a visitor is driving into this little village, and they look up and they see, oh my gosh, an avalanche up there on the ridge, way high on the mountain. This avalanche starts, and they look and they see, ah, the village is right in the way of this avalanche. It's going to come and hit the village very soon. So they rush into the little village, and they yell at everybody, you know, you guys got to evacuate. You know, the avalanche is coming. It's going to bury the village. Get out, get out, get out. And the people just look at them and says, you know, what are you talking about? Look around in the village. Everything is fine here. There's no troubles here. What are you screaming about? You must be crazy. You're a lunatic. Get out of here. And the person says, yeah, nothing. Everything seems to be okay now, but there's an avalanche coming down the mountain and is going to be here in 30 seconds. So, you know, run for your lives. And most of the people will just say, well, I don't see any evidence of that. You know, it hasn't, nothing's happened yet. I say, well, look up the mountain, look up the mountain. They say, no, we don't need to look up the mountain. We're too busy, you know, talking about politics here or something to look up the mountain side. It's like that. Warnings fall on deaf ears in this world. Everybody, they're looking to see what position others have. It's a position that they recognize. But all positions in this world that the ego recognizes, the ego leaves out the position of choosing a new idea. Leaves it out. It's not an option. It's not a recognizable option at all. That's why it's very, again, very difficult to stand up to 7 billion people when 7 billion people simply ignore you. You like, move on, nothing here. That attitude. The attitude is, there's nothing there. Now, if one person says that, 100,000 million, 7 billion, it becomes sort of exponentially more difficult, actually. If 7 billion people just say, move on, there's nothing here to see, then one starts thinking, well, wait a minute, maybe I need to change, you know, because how can I possibly be invisible to 7 billion people? But all it means is that 7 billion people are being guided by the ego. And the ego does not recognize truth. It cannot. It was born of a lie. That which is born of a lie is incapable of recognizing truth. And when the ego says that it can, it's again. You know, if the ego were to be truthful, the ego would say, I cannot recognize truth. But it won't say that. No, it will say that it can recognize it. That's a lie. Because the ego was born of the idea that spirit can become prime creator. And spirit cannot become prime creator, it's impossible. But spirit chose the idea of wanting to experience being prime creator, so mind had to present the idea. Mind has to say, yes, you can. Mind cannot say, no, you can't. That's not how mind functions. Mind is a servant of the idea that spirit chooses. So when spirit chooses the idea of wanting to be prime creator, wanting to experience being prime creator, mind says, yes, you can. It has to say that. Yes, you can, and here's how you do it. And any notion that that spirit cannot does not exist within mind's scenario that mind is presenting. So the ego is, again, the presentation by mind of, yes, you can be prime creator spirit. So when I say it's impossible, the ego say, no, there's a way to do it. When I say choose a new idea, the ego say, no, you don't need to choose a new idea. That's ridiculous. There's a way to do it. You know, when I say give up the attempt because it's futile, the ego will say, no, it's not futile. It's very possible. In fact, it's certain to succeed. And when I say the ego is a liar, the ego will say, no, I'm not. I'm telling the truth. I can recognize truth. And the truth is that it's possible for spirit to be prime creator. That's the ego's truth. But it's not truth. It's the mandate of the mind. When spirit chooses an idea, the mind has a mandate to present that idea. That's how reality works. So mind has no choice in the matter. It has to say, yes, you can. Yes, we can. It has to say that. And when I say, no, you cannot, it has to reject that. It has no choice in the matter. The ego has to lie. When mind says, yes, you can, that's a lie. So from the very beginning, this entire idea, from the very beginning, was a lie, right? There's a saying that the ego is the father of all lies, is born of a lie. All it has is lies. Its entire belief system rests on a lie. Well, what is that lie? The lie is that spirit can be prime creator. That's a lie. And again, when spirit chooses the idea of wanting to experience being prime creator, mind has to say, okay, yes, you can. Here's how you're going to do it. This is the way. And that's a lie. So it starts out from the very beginning as a lie. From the very, very, very onset, there wasn't a time when mind said, no, you can't, and then later on it changed, well, I see you can't. No, from the very beginning, mind says, oh, yeah, yes, you can, absolutely. And here's how we're going to do it. And so we're enmeshed in this, yes, you can, here's how you're going to do it scenario. When in fact, the truth is, no, you cannot, no, we cannot. And here's how we get free of the yes, we can. Okay, we get free of the yes, we can by saying, no, we cannot, and we are going to choose a new idea. The idea of not trying to experience being prime creator. That's how we get free. It's the only way we get free. We can never get free other than choosing that new idea. We can't, because we can never convince the mind, as long as we have the idea of wanting to experience being prime creator, the mind will always say, yes, you can. You can do it. The mind might use all sorts of redefinitions for us, saying, well, you can be enlightened. But what it really means is you can be experienced being prime creator, but you cannot. So in this world, when we assert, no, we cannot, we can't, you know, can't do it, the mind, 7 billion billion people will say, oh, yes, we can. Yes, we can. Absolutely, we can. We're positive we can. And anyone who says we cannot must be crazy. You see, from the logic of the ego, any assertion that we cannot is insanity. Has to be, right? Because the ego cannot admit that it's insane, because that would be saying, no, we cannot. The mind has to say, yes, we can be prime, experience being prime creator. And therefore, it has to say that saying, yes, we can is sanity, meaning it believes, yes, we can. It totally believes it. So any assertion of, no, we cannot, must be insane from that standpoint, within that system of logic. Any assertion, no, we cannot, must be insanity from that standpoint. But that standpoint is flawed, is a lie from the beginning. So you cannot have that which is a lie from the very beginning. You cannot have that be true. So when it says that it is true, and any assertion that it's not true is insanity, that's a lie. Okay? But it's very difficult when 7 billion insist that they can, yes, we can. And one says, no, we cannot. And 7 billion says, well, that one is must be completely insane. It's a difficult situation. I mean, we can't sugarcoat it. And we need to admit it's difficult. Otherwise, we'll quit. I think a lot of people have given up because they just felt a feeling of overwhelm, futility, like that's, I don't know, I don't think I'm ever gonna succeed. And maybe they didn't realize why. It's simply because of this enormous number of entities in this world right now saying, you know, that whoever says no, we cannot is insane. I felt that pressure my entire life. You know, it's there. And only someone who's established in the perfect peace can simply not even listen to that at all. Really, literally, one who is established in the effect of the idea of not trying to be prime creator, who is abiding in that perfectly stable effect, effect that undergoes no modification ever. Only that one can simply effortlessly brush aside an entire planet's condemnation of their position, an entire cosmos's condemnation of their position. Because literally the entire cosmos will have condemned their position. That is literally true. So we have to be realistic about the situation, but in hearing this, we might say, aha, now I know that there is some factor, that I can see the factor that makes it difficult, and it's not my lack of effort at all. Okay, there's a big dynamic at work here, and it's not justified in just giving up, collapsing, my will collapsing. That's not justified. What is justified is we continue to look at this more carefully. Because when we realize there's a roadblock, an obstacle, then we need to go to work on it. And as I said, it's not impossible for one to choose a new idea and experience, abide in that, abide in the self. It's not impossible. Because once one is abiding in that experience of perfect stability, then one is able to effortlessly deflect any notion of insanity, provided that the abiding is continuous and deep, and it's very you know, very effortless. There is a certain deepening to experiencing that. One gets more and more familiar with it. So it takes someone who's very, very comfortable and familiar with an effect which doesn't change, a non-modifiable effect, to brush aside 7 billion people's denunciations. And the denunciations can be scathing, you know. So of course we're hesitant. We might have the right stuff, but we're hesitant. So how to address this hesitancy is very, very important. I've been trying to address it for a long time. And as I have said, I said, hey, you know, it's very difficult now. And I think the point has been proven. So it would be ideal if we had access to a perfect touchstone or several. That would be ideal. And yet we cannot hold our breath. You know, it hasn't happened yet. And so what we need to do is continue to try and overcome this barrier. What I've experienced is that the barrier is more formidable than we expect. If we look at the change just in the last 15 years with the internet, incredible change. The barrier has become vastly more formidable, partly because we're now aware of the attitudes of people around the entire planet. Now, you know, the saying ignorance is bliss. Well, there's Apply it this way. If one is ignorant of the attitudes of the whole world, one has a small circle of friends, and one thinks, well, the attitude of the rest of the world is probably the same as my friends, and my friends are very supportive of choosing a new idea, and one thinks, well, everybody else in the world is probably very supportive, so I'm not going to worry about it. One can live in that bubble of ignorance. But right now, the problem is the entire world has now spoken up through the internet, through social media. And one is aware now of the attitudes of people from every single country, every walk of life, the entire planet. And the overwhelming realization is that there's this incredible intolerance for choosing a new idea from everybody. So suddenly the naivete, like of childhood, of thinking, you know, I bet you the whole world is a very wonderful place and people from every country are very supportive and everything's, you know, great. I bet you it is. I don't know, but I assume that. That's gone. It's been wiped away. Here in the Bay Area of California, living here is extremely great teaching aid, because there are literally people here from everywhere in the world. Everywhere in the world. And you get this massive polyglot culture of input from every type of person. And then you realize, my gosh, people all over the whole planet are all the same. They're all thinking the same way, in spite of superficial culture differences. They all have the same basic egoic orientation, everybody from the whole planet. Doesn't matter what country. And the internet then has really opened up that can of worms. And now in going through and carefully observing, you say, oh my gosh, everybody really is just following the egoic agenda from all over the entire world. So it becomes more intimidating now, way more intimidating. We cannot just naively assume that many in the world are really oriented in that way and very supportive. It's not there. We can see it. So that is part of the extreme crisis of the times. The spiritual crisis is the support that we assume might be there isn't there. And even we become aware of people on little islands throughout the world. We realize it's not idyllic at all. The people, indigenous peoples, are not, it's not idyllic. They have all their prejudices and intolerances towards truth, just like everyone else. And then you realize there's no place on the entire planet where there's not this intolerance towards truth. Nowhere. That's a great realization, actually. In the past, we always assumed that there was some magical place, some Shangri-La on the planet, some Shambhala. You know, I know people who search for that their entire lives, thinking for sure there must be an ideal place. And I myself search for it in various ways, thinking that maybe somewhere there's this island, you know, where everything is, the natives are enlightened and everything is perfect there and there's no intolerance of truth. Now we know it's not true. My gosh. And so it's an existential shock. The internet has brought this massive existential shock, and many have succumbed to this shock, to tell you the truth. The many dropouts from the spiritual path, and I hope I'm trying to bring some back right now, really. And for those who are still on it, I'm saying, don't lose your will. I've not lost mine. But realize that we're going through this existential shock of realizing there's no place on this planet where one can be free of extreme intolerance towards choosing a new idea. No place. I mean, even in, you go up, I was watching this video of the Tibetan plateau now, and how it is right now, you know, and the idea of somehow, you know, that Tibet is this place you can go and experience this wonderful tolerance for choosing truth. No way. Gone. You know? Even if it was ever there, and maybe there was some of that there at some point in time, it's gone. There's no place on this planet right now that is a very tolerant place towards choosing truth. And if that isn't a shock, I don't know what is. And so I've extrapolated from that, like maybe there's a need to go somewhere else. That's one perspective. Or there's a need for some touchstones to come into the world to provide a buffer and say, hey, you know, 7 billion may be against you, but I'm for you. And that's a heartening thing. You know, a champion, someone who champions the idea of choosing a new idea. And if one stands up and is able to withstand the scorn of an entire planet, of entire cosmos, then there will be others who will say, you know what, I'm in too. But who's the one who goes first is the question. Because going first is infinitely more difficult. Infinitely more difficult. Because they're the ones who are showing everyone else that, you see, this scorn has no effect at whatsoever. They're the, you know, the other ones are too afraid to risk it. They're not sure. So going first is a whole different ballgame for sure. And none of us want to go first. You know, I mean, to be honest about it, nobody wants to go first. In the climate of these times, who wants to be the nail that is sticking up? You know, because the planet is so embroiled in activism. Now, everybody's got a hammer. And to a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And if a nail is sticking up, get hammered down very severely. Again, which is why I have simply extrapolated that it would not be surprising if there were some kind of exodus off this planet to some other place. It would not be surprising at all. It would be totally justified, actually. You know, to a place where a situation where it's less prone to hammer down the nails that stick up, you know. Where people feel it's okay to choose a different idea. It's okay to say, no, we can't be prime creators. No, we cannot experience that. And many others will say, wonderful, great. We're supportive of that position. So in the days and the months ahead, it should be an extraordinarily interesting time. I don't want anybody to lose their nerve at this time. I don't want anybody to succumb to a bad day. Some people are having bad days now. It can happen. Have a really bad day. But you just have to say, you know what? This is a bad day, but tomorrow it could very well be a better day. And so don't let me jump to any conclusions on a really bad day. And this satsang here is at least a little bit of encouragement. You know, I realize it's not much, but maybe it makes a little difference for some of you. It helps me out, makes a difference for me, just to be able to be useful to someone somewhere is a good thing. But I'm not, you know, standing up in front of the world and saying, well, in some respects I am, but I still have a sort of buffer. But I'm not really front and center, not really. You know, it's like a supporting musician. It's not the lead singer, you know, background singer. Because the lead singer, let's say a lead singer standing up in front of a hostile audience, you know, and belting out this song, and when the audience is screaming and throwing things at them and saying, you're terrible, get off the stage. And they still maintain their voice perfectly, you know, and then the back. I think like a good singer, and you get up in front of a stage and the audience turns against you and tells you to, you know, get off stage, we can't stand you. What happens is your voice dries up. Literally, you can't sing well anymore. So the one that can stand up in front of the vast 7 billion people, audience of 7 billion, and just belt out a perfect song and not lose their voice in the slightest bit, the background singers see that, and they say, hey, let's harmonize with it. We can sing along too. We don't have to lose our voice either. And then before you know it, you've got a great song going. But for a backup singer to try and attempt that, you know, disastrous. Disastrous. You know, we're not geared to completely reject all the scorn of the planet. And the scorn is intense. It doesn't end. The ego gets furious. The ego issues threats. The ego, you know, is absolutely outraged by someone who says, no, we cannot. The mantra of the day is, yes, we can. That's the mantra of this age. It's always the mantra of the ego, but in this day and age, it's becoming overt, very overt. You know, in other words, in our face, overt. Activism, overt. We live in the age of activism, the age of instant scorn. You know, in the past, scorn was rarely used, I'm telling you that. There were so many compassionate people in the world who believed in, very much believed in salvation. They didn't exactly know how it could take place, but they believed in it, and they felt it's important to be very kind and civil to everybody. And so scorn was something that was rarely used. And even when it was used, many people disagree with it. Very much so. It doesn't matter. Didn't matter. You know, hate the sin, love the sinner was the mantra, really. And it didn't matter what anyone did, there was still love for that person. I feel that way. I know there are others who feel that way too. That there's no excuse whatsoever for entirely rejecting anybody. The highest degree of hatred is to ignore somebody and say they're irrelevant. You know, they're nothing. Move on. That's pure ego. So I don't ignore anybody. Everybody has the capacity to choose a new idea. Everyone has equal access right now. There is no issue of access. It's equal access right now. It always has been, always will be. So there's zero issue about that. No reason for anyone to feel guilty at all. Of like I'm blocking someone's access. It's impossible to block anyone's access. Impossible. Therefore, what's the basis for guilt? Everybody right now can choose a new idea and experience perfect peace beyond understanding. Right now, everyone, without jumping through any hoop at all. Simple choice that everyone is innately capable of doing. So, and no one can be blocked from that. There's just no circumstance that could ever arise that can block this simple capability to make this simple choice. Therefore, who is guilty of what? That is the question. That is the question. That changes everything, doesn't it? It gives you a different perspective on social justice, on everything. Because the fact is that the ego uses circumstance in this world to justify delay. And it's called victim consciousness. And that's very, very prevalent in today's world. You can always tell in a world where victim consciousness becomes prevalent that this is the world is succumbing to severe egoic delusion. There is no situation that anyone can ever be in where they do not have access to choosing a new idea. This was symbolized in the crucifixion scene where the two thieves on the side of Jesus, and one of them is spitting and cursing him and, you know, refuses to repent. He's saying basically, these circumstances I'm in, you know, free me from the cross first. And then the other thief says, look, I know what I did, you know, I'm suffering the punishment for what I did, the socially accepted punishment. I accept that fact. But I also see, you know, what you are. That you're the voice of the overlay. You're the presence, you're the touchstone, the presence of the overlay, the peace beyond understanding. It's right here. And I see it. And I say, that's it. I know that's what's true. And then Jesus said, right now you'll be with me in paradise, just like that. In other words, the thief didn't make an excuse saying, I'm being crucified. There's no possible way I could choose this peace. You know, I'm being blocked from it. No, the thief said, no, I see. I'm not blocked from it. Because Jesus refused to use his circumstances as an excuse. But he basically, what this narrative shows us is that making excuses is invalid. Even at the point of crucifixion, it doesn't block our capability to choose a new idea. There's no way we can be blocked. Even being tortured, we can't be blocked. And that the ego puts us through all this horrendous stuff to justify its telling us that we can be blocked from it, that somehow we don't have equal access, somehow we have to do something first, which is a lie. And we will put ourselves through all sorts of victimization in order to provide the excuse the ego will then use for us. The ego says that it needs an excuse, and it tells us, just do this and you'll find out that you'll have some kind of peace of mind. And the peace of mind the ego tells you is that it tells you that you're blocked from choosing a new idea. And therefore you get to keep the yes we can mantra going. Yes, we can be prime creator. So yes, the ego's sole objective, sole purpose, it can't have another one. Even though it says it can, it cannot. And so victimization literally is a tool that the ego uses. And those have been victimized, we all have, I certainly have in my life. And it was my own fault, you know. I chose to go along with the ego a little bit, and what did the ego do? The gift the ego gave me? Victimization. And that's the ego's, you know, its prime gift. It says, here, I have this great gift for you. I say, what's that for? It says, well, you can now claim that you failed to choose a new idea because you were blocked. You see, it's not your fault. Something external to you blocked it. Your victimization blocked it. You couldn't do it at that time. And of course, then you say, well, I want to do it now. And then the ego, what does it do? Gives you more victimization. So if you look at the world in that way, look at it that victimization is simply used to provide excuses for us to not choose a new idea, to not experience, not give up, is an excuse for us to maintain our yes we can belief that we can be prime creator. That's what it is. And the ego will say, well, you can't choose a new idea because you're blocked. This victimization has blocked you. There's no way you could do it because you've been victimized. What you need is reparations from those who victimized you and jumped through all these hoops and blah blah blah, and before you know it, you've delayed your whole lifetime. The wise people come to a point when they realize that they participated in their own victimization. They actually allowed ego to arrange that for them so that they'd have an excuse. But remember the thief on the cross, he said to Christ, saying, ah, I'm not using this as an excuse. No way. I see what you're all about. I understand. That choose a new idea. Repent. The thief repented. Just before he died from crucifixion, the thief repented and said, I'm not going to use this as an excuse. Just like that, Jesus says, you'll be with me in paradise, guaranteed. Like that. Okay. We have to be that same way. We have to say, no way am I using any excuse, because I know it's just an excuse. Everything, any not choosing a new idea is an excuse. We're using an excuse, a false excuse. And whatever excuse seems plausible to us, the ego will say, ah, you know, you were victimized and you can't do it because you need a restitution. You need to pursue this grievance. Somebody else has power over you now, is keeping you from choosing this. Keeps the whole circus going, doesn't it? But in this day and age, there is this enormous belief that victimization is actually blocking us. And those who have been quote-unquote victimized don't have access to choosing a new idea, and therefore they need to be, reparations must be made. It's not true. It's a lie of the ego. And there are wise people in every walk of the world who understand what's being said here. And there are those who have gone through a victimization experience who understand what's being said here, guaranteed. And there are those who say, no, I'm not going to use that as an excuse, no way. Because I see it's an excuse, and I wanted an excuse, so I was given an excuse. But now I say, nah, it's completely invalid. Everyone has equal access. It's impossible not to, because all it takes is a simple choice. And then the overlay, they experience that effect. The effect is instantaneously present. There's no process involved whatsoever. There is no way that anyone can ever be victimized to take away equal access. It's completely impossible. So that's the foundation of a sane society, is that there is no such thing as any type of victimization that can take away one's equal access to choosing a new idea. So there's no real guilt to deal with at all, because no one's blocking anyone from it. No one's blocking anyone. What the ego insists is that somehow people are being blocked from, yes, we can be prime creator, and that they're failing because something is blocking from that. victimized and they're failing because of the victimization. That's another spin the ego puts on it. That the only reason we're failing to be prime creators because we've been victimized in some way, which again is nonsense. It's another lie. We're failing because it's impossible from the very beginning. Nobody's ever caused us to fail. Okay? No one has ever caused us to fail to be prime creator because it's impossible from the very beginning. It's an impossibility. The will of God is cannot be controverted, cannot be changed. There's no will that we be prime creator. We're prime created. So you have a world right now who's rabidly egoic, I would say, like rabid dogs, very activist about it, you know, very, very adamant that, you know, somebody is blocking us from succeeding, or we can't access truth because somebody is blocking us from it. We're being blocked, and we need to find that nail that's sticking up and hammer it down. You know, everybody's got a hammer now. Hammer it down. That's just the facts of the situation. And I can compare that to previously. And I'm saying it's much, much, much worse now. The seeds of it were there in the past. That is true. But, you know, it hadn't grown so big. We have a lush jungle now of it before. Maybe we just have smaller plants. But now it's turned into a jungle. So there's not this amorphous difficulty that we think we're just inadequate, we can't do it. No, the difficulty is coming from all these troubles, from this opposition, from this pressure that we're under, egoic pressure. We're under egoic pressure in a lot of different ways on this planet. So many different ways we're under pressure. I've said before, many places we're under extraterrestrial pressure as well, enormous. And we're seen as, so we're supposed to serve their agenda. Everybody in the cosmos believes that others are supposed to serve their agenda. You know, they have an agenda and they see others as needing to comply with that agenda, even if it's an agenda of quote-unquote peacefulness. Sometimes that's the one that's most demanding. But again, there is no agenda in the cosmos that you need to serve, anyone needs to serve, because everyone has equal access at this very moment, and every moment, each and every moment, choose a new idea. Experience the effect of that idea, which is the overlay, the effect that is non-modifiable, that is perfectly stable, the effect that has always been stable from the very beginning, always will be perfectly stable, never changing. Experience that effect. Everyone has equal access, and will always have equal access. There's no situation that anyone can ever be put in where they don't have equal access to this. Immediate equal access right now. So why do we need agendas in the cosmos? Why do we need to even a peaceful agenda? Because that essentially says, well, we don't have equal access yet. We need to bring equality to the cosmos. That's nonsense. We already have always had equal access. There's nothing that can change that fact, because we were created with, the way we were created was the authority, the capacity to choose ideas and experience those ideas. And we cannot change that fact. So we always have the innate created authority by prime creator to choose new ideas. That's how we function. That can never be taken away from us. So that's within us. We have the capability to do that. Never can be taken away from us. The very fact that of asserting that somehow we're blocked is a lie. It's a denial of what we are. The fact that asserting that we need to do something first before we have this capacity is a lie. It's a denial of what we are. The very the assertion that we somehow need to spread unity is a lie, because that's a denial that unity is already present. Unity of capacity is already present. Perfect capacity. Unblemished, uncorrupted capacity to choose a new idea. the assertion that somehow that's not true is a lie. It's a denial of what we are. Very simple. It's the ego. Maybe in a so-called benevolent guise. I mean, the ego can seem very benevolent, saying we need to spread, we have an agenda of spreading peace and unity and oneness throughout the cosmos. That seems very benevolent. But it's actually the height of delusion. Because perfect unity is already present, meaning everyone has equal access to choosing a new idea and experiencing the perfect peace of that idea. It's already there. So asserting that we need to work toward it is asserting that it's not there right now. It is there right now. It's always been there. Will always be there exactly the way it is now, exactly the way it's always been. We can never improve upon it because it's already 100% perfect. Equal access, level playing field. It's already 100% perfect. So there's no point in trying to make it better that way. What we need to do is share this knowledge of this fact. That's what's helpful. But that's a far cry from asserting that it's not there and that we need to somehow get it there. Okay, that's false egoic teachings. False spirituality. Egoic spirituality is to assert that it's not there yet and we need to do something to get it there. It's not true. Real true teachings, I say, it's always been there. It's never been lacking. Perfect access has always been the case, always will be the case. There's nothing that can change that. The thief on one side of Jesus was spitting and cursing their fate. You know, what an awful, terrible fate. You know, saying, thinking that, you know, somehow they didn't have the capacity to choose a new idea, that fate had robbed them of that capacity. Not true. Not true. But we certainly can make some very good illusions of that, can't we? Some mirages that seem to be very intense. Like, oh yeah, that person, certainly they were robbed of their capacity. Something happened to them, they were victimized, and that robbed them of their capacity to fully be what they are, etc., etc. Well, it may have damaged the personality development, but that has nothing to do, doesn't mean that their capacity to choose a new idea has been diminished or robbed at all. Because it's not the personality that chooses a new idea, it's spirit, you see. In the egoic world, belief system, its personality is the one that's supposed to, is the hero, is the one that's supposed to be able to choose. And so if the personality development is damaged, the ego insists that the capacity to choose a new idea has been damaged. Not true. That's a lie. Because it's spirit that chooses a new idea. Personality has absolutely nothing to do with it. So whatever condition the personality is in is irrelevant. It's spirit at every moment has the authority and capacity, capability to choose a new idea that can never be changed. So it doesn't matter. The personality could be, you know, what the personality is. It doesn't make any difference to this central fact. So perfect equality is already present, not among personalities, but among spirit. And what we are is spirit. We're not spirit / personality. We're 100% spirit. Just being presented a delusional scenario by mind that somehow personality is now in charge and is important. It's just a tool of forgetfulness is what it is. It's an excuse maker, personality. It's the excuse maker. Ego just uses the personality as an excuse. That's why the ego is desperate to keep the personality. The ego's terrified if you try to drop the personality, you know, because that's the ego's excuse maker. Personality can be attacked, can be victimized, harmed, all sorts of terrible things can happen. Can be improved upon, right? All these modifications can take place. And so it's the perfect excuse maker. The ego will just point to the personality and say, well, you know, these things have happened and we can't do it yet. So the ego will say, yeah, sure, we're going to do it, but not yet. But it's spirit that does the choosing. God didn't, the prime creator didn't create personality, he created spirit. Spirit is endowed with the capability to choose ideas. So it's spirit that chooses a new idea, not personality. So whatever victimization that personality has gone through, that doesn't in any way block spirit from choosing a new idea. Therefore, why even go through victimization, you know? Anyone who chooses the ego is likely to undergo some type of victimization, some type of modification. That's its stock in trade. difficulties will arise, no question about it. One doesn't even have to have a personality. When one chooses a new idea, one experiences perfect peace. There's no reason for an excuse maker then, is there? They say that when this happens, it's like when one turns off a fan, overhead fan, or a fan of any type, and turns it off, the fan blade is still circulating, still going around and around and around. But the momentum is slowing, and eventually it comes to a halt. And they say that it's like that with the personality. One chooses to experience perfect stability, perfect peace, and the personality dynamics are still whirling around, but they gradually they slow down, slow down, slow down, like that. That's possible, like that. But the excuse maker is not needed. There's no need for the ego to point to something and saying, you can't do it yet because there's something that needs to be modified here with the personality. So the personality is central to the ego's delusion, to the yes we can, and to delaying no we can't. Central. The body is central. Of course, the body can be victimized, right? It can be harmed. It's vulnerable. That's central to the ego. All important. Which is why the ego always... it draws us back into identifying with another body. So the ego can keep making excuses and keep in charge, saying, yes, we can. It will always do that. Yes, we can. Yes, we can be prime creator. And we just have to get it right somehow and need another body to make excuses of why we failed, why we haven't succeeded yet, and why we cannot drop this whole idea and choose a new one. It's the great excuse maker. Some people here come here identify with the body. The body is there, but they're not using it at all. The personality doesn't matter because they're entirely coming from the standpoint of spirit. And they're abiding in this perfect peace. So the personality, the body's there, the personality might be there. Nothing to them. They don't use it as an excuse at all. They don't need to be victimized at all. It's very possible. So we're getting into very core elements here. This is the type of terrain that one traverses in satsang. Heavy-duty terrain, it seems that way, you know. Seems like this is a... terra incognita, unknown territory that we're not sure, you know, where do we step? Where do we step next? You know, you're very careful, you know, where do I put my foot next on this? Because it seems to be unfamiliar. But if it's familiar territory, in my case, it's familiar enough, I can just spontaneously talk about it like this. Because I've traversed it, you know, through this many, many, many times, and I realize, okay, the footing is very sure here. It's not slippery. Not a slippery slope. It's very flat, very easy. But we keep thinking that the next step is going to be slippery, but it's not. It's the ego that's slippery. Again, we just simply say, no, we cannot. We cannot be prime creator. What's slippery about that? Nothing. It's the yes, we can that's very slippery. Because then the excuses need to come up. The ego needs to protect this. It needs to protect it from the no, we cannot, and it needs to protect it from the fact that it fails. Yes, we can fails. There's that double whammy on the ego because nobody has ever succeeded in being prime creator because it's impossible. So the ego has to somehow account for this failure, and it also has to account for the desire to give up this idea. So, you know, say, no, we cannot do it. It has to try and deflect that away. Give excuses. So it's excuses in all directions. It has to constantly be presenting all these excuses to us. And if we want an excuse, of course, we'll get it. No doubt about that. And to some degree, we all want some excuse, something we can point to and say, I would do it except for this little problem, you know, this little excuse. And the ego's the great excuse maker. And the voice of reason just says, no, there's no excuse. Equal access. Always, that's the case. And the quality of the idea, the effect, the non-modifiable effect, the quality of that peace, the isness, the stillness, is exactly the same now as it always will be. It's completely unchangeable, cannot be changed. So the idea that we're waiting for it to get better is, again, another lie of the ego. It's an excuse. The idea that we're waiting for it to settle down is an excuse. The idea that somehow it's going to drop, change in some way, and we need to wait for that change, that's another excuse, another lie. But the fact that 7 billion people will hold you up to ridicule and scorn, that's a fact. The ego says, oh, no, you know, nah, it's not so bad. Not so bad. And we may think that that's reassuring, but it's not. Because then we feel some sort of reluctance on our part, and we can't figure out where it's coming from. And then we figure out, well, maybe we're just inadequate, that we're not cut out for this inquiry. You see, the ego's very tricky. So the ego will pretend to be helpful for us and say, oh, no, the world, it's not that bad. The world will be pretty supportive of you, really. And not, what are you worrying about? There's nothing really to worry about. That's not true. The world will not be supportive. And again, if we hear that, yes, the world will be supportive, well, then we think there's something wrong with me because I thought that the world's not supportive, but I guess I'm not feeling right. I can't trust that my feet intuition. And the ego must be right in saying, and so there must be some other reason I'm reluctant, where in fact, the reluctance actually does come from the fact that the world is very non-supportive of it. Again, very clever of the ego to seem to side with truth like this. But it's only doing it to deflect your attention away and make you feel inadequate and incapable. So when you can pin the reluctance on specific areas and see that indeed reluctance is coming from that area, then you don't feel so inadequate. You say, you know, there's a reason why I feel reluctant. And it's because the collective focus of the world right now is drastically on the ego and its guidance and agenda. And therefore, definitely, scorn will be there. And doubts and misinterpretations and, you know, very tough. It's very tough. And then you can see that. And you can say, okay, well, I'm realistic. I'm right. At least I'm right about that. And then you look for a way to overcome that with open eyes, open ears, knowing that it is a legitimate, severe stumbling block. But the ego does a deflection away from that. Says, don't even look at that at all. No, that's not true. Everything will be fine. Everybody will love you. But there must be some other problem. And then that deflects you away, and you don't pay attention to that, and you don't find ways to get past it. And you're just spinning your wheels. It's pretty scary. The cleverness of the ego is scary. You see that, and you say, holy cow. What other tricks does the ego have? Well, it's got plenty. But there's no tricks that it has that cannot be simply looked at carefully and examined, just looked at it and say, okay, that's just another lie. Just another lie. And you don't have to look at all the tricks. Eventually, you go towards the point of just realizing the ego is has to lie. So why even pay attention to anything it says? You know, it has to lie. It has no choice but to lie. It's born of a lie. The idea that mind can experience being prime creator is a lie. And that idea gives rise to an attempt to prove that it's true. It's useless. So everything has to be a lie that's presented. Because everything is the premise is a lie. That we're capable. Yes, we can. We can do it. That's a lie. And a lie can never be true. A lie can never be true. So if the premise is a lie, any attempts to accomplish it must also be a lie. Because it's saying, all attempts must be saying, yes, we can. We can do it. Otherwise, if we saw it's impossible, why would we make attempts? If one sees clearly that something's impossible, they won't make attempts to do it. Even the whimsical attempts are rooted that a whim might succeed where logical, determined processes won't. Maybe a whim will succeed. So we try that. We just say, hey, you know, we'll take a flyer on it. And what the heck, we'll just see. Maybe we just do a crazy thing and maybe that'll succeed. Doesn't succeed. Whims don't make lies true. Whimsical action won't make lies true. And yet we think that maybe that's our only hope, because we can see clearly that reasonably it's impossible. So we say, let's just toss all reason to the wind, and maybe a crazy whim will work. Right? There's no logic to it at all, right? So that's the attraction of the whim is very strong, because where logic and truth and reason fail, we think, well, a whim might work magically. We don't know how it works. Just magically it somehow works. And so we are vulnerable to whims, whimsical action. And say, let's just do something stupid. Let's do something crazy. Let's just, on a whim, throw our fate to the winds and see where it lands, you know. Doesn't work either. What is impossible is impossible. Whims, truth is not at the mercy of whims. But at least it gives us the a feeling like it's possible, because there's no thought, no reason to it, a whim, right? It's like we reach an impasse, we see, it's impossible, and then we say, well, let's just jump anyway and see what happens, see what happens. Doesn't work, that won't work either. And there's really no way to assess the failure of it either, because it's just there was no logic to it in the first place. All we can say is, well, it didn't work that time. But we say, well, but who knows, maybe it can work next time. So the illogic of whims can really trip us up. Because there's no logic there at all, there's no reason there at all. You might ask someone, why did you do that? And they say, I don't know, I just said, what the heck? Let me just, you know, I'll just spontaneously, let me just try something. Maybe it'll work. That's like someone trying to drink up all the water in the oceans, and they keep dipping a cup into the ocean, you know, and they drink the cup, seawater, it'll feel terrible. And still the ocean is there, you know, it doesn't succeed. And so one day they just suddenly, spontaneously, they suddenly just go running out of the ocean and dive down in the ocean and just start gulping all the water, you know, saying, and they come back staggering to shore, you know, throwing up in a horrible, wretched condition, and someone asks, what in the world did you do that for? And they say, I don't know, I just felt like, you know, just on a whim, I just thought maybe this would work. And then maybe sometime they go back to dipping cups in the ocean and drinking it that way, and then that doesn't work. And at some other point they may suddenly dive into the ocean saying, well, and they come back and then someone asks them, why'd you do that? You've done it before, and I did it again. They say, well, yeah, it didn't work the first time. I don't know why, but maybe I thought the second time doing it, just, it might work. Who knows? You know, it might be magically happen. Reality doesn't function through magic. Reality is set. There's a set way that it works, that it functions. Can't be changed. So whims have no effect on it whatsoever. We can spend eternity in whimsical behavior, believing that magically somehow it will change reality, but it never will. And the notion that somehow we don't understand whims, sure we understand them, because it's basically just a petulant, you know, attitude on our part of saying, just feeling, want to say, yes, I can do it, I know there's a way. There must be a way. That's spiritual pride. There must be a way. Even a whim is based on the belief there must be a way. So it's still a denial of reality. Still a refusal to say, no, we can't. What it's saying is, there must be a magical way, because we don't see any possible way it can happen, but there must be a magical way. But I'm saying, no, there is no way. No way whatsoever to accomplish the impossible. No logical way, no magical way. No way at all. So sometimes the world can throw themselves into whimsical behavior. Now, we're getting to the crux of this video, this satsang. I talked earlier about a black swan event, about a precipitating event, as I call it, in the world, and how I believe that something like that will take place. I've seen that. Now, right now, if we logically look at the world, we say, well, there's checks and balances, and there's ways to contain it. Whatever happens can be contained. But consider this. What if the world, in the way that is so collective, group mind-oriented right now, what if a whim got into the world? What if the world suddenly decided to be whimsical? What if the mood suddenly seized the world to be whimsical? Okay, what would happen then? We don't know, do we? It could be that precipitating event. It could be the black swan situation where something unpredictable takes place. Right now, we're still operating from a logical perspective of, okay, trouble's going to come, but there's checks and balances. We can contain anything. We know how to deal with it to some extent. But if the world suddenly goes whimsical, what happens? Like the analogy of the ocean trying to drink up the whole ocean in a cup, and we say, well, we know what pretty much what to expect, and we're going to drink a cup, we're going to get sick and throw up, we're going to drink another cup, get sick, and we know that, you know, that happens. But what if someone suddenly dives into the ocean and just starts gulping, trying to drink it up that way? You know, it's a whole different level of sickness, isn't it? You might even die from doing that. That's whimsical behavior. So whimsical behavior, how do we know when it breaks out? That is the question. It's not something that can be easily determined logically, right? Or plausibly or reasonably at all. It's like a tipping point is suddenly reached. And something from deep within us reaches a point where we feel like there's no way we can accomplish the impossible by being logical and by going through some logical process. Whatever we've tried doesn't work. Nothing works. And so suddenly this desire to be whimsical can suddenly arise out of nowhere, seemingly. Irrational behavior suddenly takes place. Boom. We don't know why. That's why we say that people suddenly snap, become suddenly irrational, suddenly whimsical behavior. What happens when that occurs on a global level? And who's to say it cannot? Given the dynamics of the ego, who's to say it cannot? I guarantee you it can happen. And people can say, well, we'd never know when it can happen. Well, that's where intuition and divine guidance can come into play. Where it is actually foreseeable, but it's only foreseeable from that which is perfectly clear. Because they can see that a tipping point is being reached. And there's various factors that can trigger whimsical behavior. There definitely are. It's difficult to determine, no question about it. Very, very difficult. But if the global scale, if this contagion of whimsical behavior suddenly took root and spread like a wildfire through social media and the internet and all the various means, ways and means, and people right now have very little defense against whimsical behavior, very little defense, because they feel trapped, they feel that nothing is working, and they look ahead into the future and they realize that future is toast. You know, you have to look for the red flags when you're looking for a possibility of a whimsical behavior on a global scale. You have to look at the future and the red flags and the despair that people may feel about the future. If they look into the future and they feel that they don't really have any future, they see that Social Security is going to go broke, Medicare is going to go broke, the student loan situation is going to be impossible, the debt situation in the world is impossible. That all these factors, you know, that they realize, you know, the future is just not going to happen for them. That can trigger whimsical behavior. They become vulnerable. It's like their immune system, the immunity towards whimsical behavior becomes depressed, very depressed. And then somehow someone triggers it. There's a triggering event that somehow people start suddenly, and it snowballs. It's like an avalanche happening. And before you know it, those with lower resistance to whimsical behavior are swept in this great snowball. And it snowballs and snowballs and snowballs. And before you know it, the whole world has just gone nuts, gone berserk. It's something that can happen here. It's something that I've seen that will happen here. Because the future really is blocked. It's really blocked. And people can feel that. You know, and it's crazy to say, no, everything's fine, because it's not fine. The debt situation is not fine. We're just kicking the can down the road. Global economic health is terrible, it's even terminal. We're just delaying things as best we can. But for young people, you know, there's not enough delay for them. For older people, they think, well, you know, things maybe won't get so bad for another 10 years. I can, you know, I can get along for a while, and that'll be enough. But for young people, they say, my gosh, you know, I'll be in the prime of my life when all this dead end happens. And then they say that, you know, that triggers then whimsical behavior, magical behavior. In the past, for instance, here's an analogy. When the North American Indians were being harassed and eliminated and driven out of the lands that they traditionally occupied and rounded up onto reservations, and basically their culture being destroyed, they saw no future to their culture, to their civilization, to their way of life, and they were accurate. There was no future here. Hindsight shows us there was no real future. They were crushed. What happened was someone started what's called ghost dancing. They started dancing, and that snowballed and became a mania, and spread. And what happens is there would just be this nonstop dancing for, I don't know how, continuously, until just complete exhaustion came in, and there was this frantic dancing, and the belief was that this dancing was going to change everything and drive the settlers, European, Northern Europeans, out of North America. That was the belief. And that was whimsical behavior, and it gripped the culture so severely because they saw no future, so they had to indulge in this whimsical behavior of ghost dancing, believing that this would magically restore what had been taken away from them, the collapse of their culture and civilization and lands and everything. Horrible situation. So it has happened just recently, not so long ago. When enough people see their future is not there for them, that can trigger, almost very likely to trigger, whimsical behavior on a mass scale. So we're at a situation that could happen, probably will happen. And when the world's gone berserk, when the world goes into whimsical, there's no logic. You can't reach them. You cannot reach them when they're in that condition, because they're trusting in magic. Whereas here, we're trusting in truth, which is perfectly reasonable. We don't need to trust in any magic whatsoever. Okay, it's time to wrap this up right now. And it's been a very good one. Very, very good one. We'll see you next time. Very great. That's it.